There are, we finish the consequentials and non-consequentials theories. There are two more theories which don't fall in either of these categories. They are quite sophisticated. Okay? Even more sophisticated than Kantian theory. So I will need a little more than your usual attention and mental alertness. One theory is called the theory, Rawlsian theory of justice, or the veil of ignorance. John Rawls was a professor at Harvard, a professor of philosophy at Harvard University until about 5 years ago when he died. Rawls have said one objective in his life, to answer the following question. How can people full of biases and vested interests can ever how people who are selfish and full of biases and vested interests can ever be fair to other people? Okay. Actually, he had four conditions. He says how people who are selfish, rational, have vested interests, and are full of bias. How can they be fair to other people? Okay. Let's take the four things in turn. First, you understand that we are all selfish, right? We put ourselves above others. And this comes from where? Where does our selfishness come from? Who is going to tell us? Who is, yes?
From ourselves, human nature.
Human nature. The self-preservationistic. That's something the animals have to do, by the way, right? Yeah. The animals don't walk through the street and run the bother by the way, but sometimes they do. So the self-preservation instinct gives us the selfishness, the self-centeredness, the egoism. The second characteristic we have is that we are rational. What means you are rational?
Even
animals may be rational. What?
We evaluate our actions and what we do based on some norms.
Yes. So I have here 50 cents and 2 euros. Which one I give you? Which you prefer?
Yeah, 2 euros.
Okay, she's rational. She prefers more to less. Huh? Rational, orthologismos. Okay? Rationality means we prefer more to less. Given a choice, right? We prefer more to less. Where this comes from? Where this comes from?
Greed.
Where greed comes from?
Self-preservation.
Also from self-preservation. Can you think if, yes, we are selfish, self-centered, but we are not rational. We choose less to more. If every time you're given a choice, you choose less to more. If you are a businessman, you buy something, and you pay 100 euros, and you sell it for 50. What will happen to you?
Close down.
You come back. You close down. Think you go to buy something. You ask Marina. You go to buy the shirt you are wearing. the blouse, and you ask the shop, how much is it? And she tells you it's 200 euros. And you say, take 500. What will happen? Okay, at the end, you're going to go bankrupt, and you go to disappear, right? If you are not rational, even if it's selfish, if you are not rational, at the end you go bankrupt. And at the end you are outcompeted from the market and outcompeted from the world, right? So you're not only selfish, but you are rational. And rationality also implies efficiency. You try to minimize cost and maximize benefits, right? Okay. So those two things we cannot get rid of, right? We have to, it's part of our DNA. We can control them, but we can manage our selfishness, we can manage our rationality, but we cannot get rid of them. Then we have two other characteristics. We have subconscious biases. We have talked about those, right? Subconscious biases, pogadalipsis, which they are ingrained in us from childhood, from society, our parents, our teachers, the culture, the television, the internet, etc. With that, it's very difficult to get rid of. If possible, we can control it, we can be aware of it, and we show some strategies. But still, it's a very strong force in our subconscious. And you saw it yourselves when you try the IAT test on the computer. And the fourth characteristic we have vested interest. We have vested interest. If you are victorious, you are a young man, you are Greek Cypriot, and this defines certain vested interest. I don't know where you come from. Maybe if you are in real estate, you have vested interest in real estate, you have vested interest, you have interest in some...
Operation.
Okay. But you have certain vested interests, and if we touch those interests, you are going to progress. I mean, you have vested interests which are different than Elvans, who are different than Lulas, and different than Alexander. Each of us has vested interests based on what family we belong, what jobs we are in, what kind of property we have, and so on. We have vested interests, all of us. You know, objectivement, right? So Rawls asked this question: how can people who are selfish, rational, full of biases, and with vested interest, how can they ever be fair to other people? How can they be fair? How can they be just? Ricky. For 40 years was trying to solve this problem and couldn't solve it. But one day, as he was working or sitting in his porch in Cambridge, Massachusetts, he had a eureka experience. One evening, a eureka. Is it a eureka? Eureka. A eureka experience. Fortunately, at the time, he was dressed. So,
unlike
Archimedes, you know the Archimedes Eureka experience. Actually, recently I was visiting Syracuse, and I visited the Archimedes Museum there, because he lived in Syracuse. You know Archimedes. It's amazing. If you ever go to Sicily, you should visit the Archimedes Museum. It's, by the way, Sicily is a wonderful, beautiful place. Anyway, so Archimedes, you know the story goes that Archimedes was presented one time by the king of Syracuse with a crown, a golden crown. And he was told that by the king, the king told Archimedes, I gave a goldsmith a piece of gold, and I asked him to make me this crown, and he made this wonderful crown, so beautiful nobody ever seen such a plan, except that I have a sneaky suspicion that the goldsmith kept some of the gold, and that inside this crown there is something else, that this is gold-plated and not real gold. So, without harming it at all, scratching it, I would like you to find out whether this is pure, solid gold or whether it's gold-plated. So Archimedes was working on it day and night.
Wait. You need to wait.
Yeah, but at that time they didn't know the relationships of mass and weight and volume and so on. So Archimedes was making different calculations and all these kind of things. And it was a hot summer day in Syracuse. So he thought to take a bath. So he opened the tap. And he went back to his calculations, he forgot, and the tap was overfilled. When he sat in, the water came out and gave him the idea of the relationship between volume, weight, and so on, mass. So he jumped out of his bathtub and started running in the streets of Syracuse, shouting, "Eureka, Eureka, Eureka, Eureka." So the similar experience happened with John Rawls. He solved his problem, suddenly he had this Eureka experience. What was his Eureka? His Eureka was the veil of ignorance. What is the veil of ignorance? The veil of ignorance says, the only way that human beings who are selfish, irrational, and full of bias and vested interest can be fair to other people is if they manage to put themselves behind a veil of ignorance as to their status, as to who they are. Right? What does this mean?
Means homeless person. You at that stage you minimize all these four forces.
The means. You can go back to your original position before you leave, you haven't been yet conceived, right? Okay. In that state, you have only two characteristics. Which are they, of the four?
The first two,
i.e.?
Selfish and rational.
You are selfish and rational, because that's what nature will give you to bring to the world. You have no biases and no vested interests. Still, you are selfish and rational. So Rawls says, if human beings manage to put themselves behind a veil of ignorance as to their status, as to whether they are young or old, rich or poor, Greeks or Turks, men or women, young or old, right? They just put themselves in the original position, who are just spirits. Then, in that state, they can be fair to others, even if they continue to be selfish. And that's what he calls the veil of ignorance. You know this veil? The veil is? In Greek, we call it? Peplum, burka. Shador,
Mandila.
But not one of whom you can see through, right?
Not
super cold. Okay? Now, we can do a test on this. I have with me a CD. With which I can hypnotize you. And make you go behind the veil of ignorance as to who you are. I can do that in 20 minutes. I have one problem. I don't know what to do with you after. because for the next 4 or 5 hours you cannot drive a car, you will not know where you are. And I think I need the permission to do that. There is an ethical issue. But John Rawls did that with permission, and he proved his point. Okay. I'm not going to use the city. However, I'm going to do a simulation with you. Okay? I will ask you, I will give you 1 minute, one to 2 minutes, during which you will try to forget everything about yourself. Okay? You will close your eyes. You, by trying to forget that who you are, you, what family you have, what everything. For a moment, you are not going to be victorious. You don't know whether you are a man or a woman. Huh? You can be 2 months old or 102 years old. You don't know. You could be a Turk, an American, a Russian, whatever. Okay? Same thing with all of you. You don't know where you're from, you don't know your name, you don't know. You know, there is a, has anybody gone to the Sturbridge village in Massachusetts? Sturbridge. If you go to Massachusetts, you go to Sturbridge village. Sturbridge village is a village that's a stuck in time. 400, 500 years ago, when the United States first started, when the first Americans were there. This village has no roads, has no electricity. Has no nothing of the modern, no cars, no.
Amish
no.
Are there?
Huh?
Amish.
No, no, it's not right. Okay. This is a village museum. The people who live there speak as they spoke at that time. They dress as they dress at that time. They raise their children as they raise their time at that time, and so on. When you go in there and you talk to them. Okay, you ask them of things that existed 400 years ago, they know about them. But you ask them about aeroplanes, about cars, about computers, about this.
It's Amish, or someone said it.
No, it's not Amish. This is Sturbridge Village, it's a living museum. And so, they don't understand anything that happened after the year 1600. Now, the same way, when you wake up after the 1 or 2 minutes, if I ask you, what's your name, where are you from, what are you, where are you? You don't know anything, okay? Forget everything, okay? It's not easy, but try it, okay? So you abstract from your vested interests and you are subconscious biases by bringing yourself back to before you were born. So think you are a spirit, okay? You ready?
It's important. Close the lights.
It's important to remember. It's important to remember when you wake up, when you come back, you do not know who you are. You are only a spirit, and therefore, this is the important part. You have equal mathematical probability to be born as anyone. This is a significant part. After we close our eyes and we come back, okay, we come back as spirits, and we have equal probability to be anyone. You have equal probability to be Nicholas, to be George, to be Elena, to be George, to be Yula. Each of you have equal probability to be anyone. You have equal probability to be a beggar as to be Bill Gates. You can equate to be a king or be a giant. Okay? You understand? Okay. This is important. The important thing, remember, you now know exactly who you are. But when you wake up after this, you are only a spirit. And you have equal probability, because I'm going to ask you a test after that. I was a question. And you have to answer the questions I will give you. Being a spirit with equal probability to come into life as man or woman, poor or rich, able or disabled, Greek or Turk, American or Russian, and equal mathematical probability. Okay. So, 1, 2, 3. Close your eyes. Completely. And think. You are a spirit, you are not who you are. Forget who you are.
Okay.
Up. So,
George,
where are you from, Marina? Okay, your spirit. Now, I'm asking you. You are about to born in a society, your spirits. You are about to be conceived and born in a society. And we are going to determine now the constitution of that society. We are going to ask three questions, one political, one economic, and one social. The political question. In the society you are about to be born into, remember, you don't know if you are men, women, young, old, Greek, Turk, what you are going to be born. Just kidding. In the society you are going to be born into, how much freedom do you like? How much freedom would you like to have? For example, how much freedom for, let's say, for women you would have in that society?
What is freedom?
Freedom to do whatever you want.
But you don't know what is freedom.
Well, you know freedom, correct? Just do whatever you want.
Freedom has the limits and serve the boundaries of the other, of the freedom of the next to me.
Why do you care about the next to you?
No limits.
Why do you care? Okay, why don't you say you want freedom for Greek Cypriots, young men, Greek Cypriots? Why do you care for anybody else? You are selfish, you are rational, you want maximum freedom for yourself.
No limits.
Think about it. I told you something before you went to... Yes, selfish and rational. So you want the maximum freedom for yourself.
Yes.
So you just said, I want maximum freedom for young, Greek Cypriot men. Why do you say that?
But he doesn't know if he's Greek or woman.
He doesn't know whether he's man or woman. He doesn't know whether
he's Greek.
He doesn't know. Therefore, he wants freedom, maximum freedom. He wants maximum freedom also for women. Why? Because he has?
He might be a woman.
No.
Yeah, exactly. Because you have equal mathematical probability to be a woman. 50-50 chance to be a woman. Okay. So, what about for Turks? Do you want freedom for Turks?
No.
No.
They have freedom.
That's not the question. You don't know how you want the freedom. You are a spirit. Do you have freedom for Turks?
No.
Yes, you want equal freedom for Turks. Why? Because you have equal mathematical probability to be a Turk. Remember, you don't have a state interest. You don't have biases. You haven't lived yet.
But I'm selfish, so.
You are selfish. So? Let's suppose. Exactly. But, yes, you have maximum freedom for you. The only problem is you don't know whether you're going to be Greek, Turk, Russian, American, that's what you're not. If you provide freedom, let's say for the Greeks, and you are going to Turk, you are in deep shit. You understand that?
Yes.
You are going to be a slave all your life. Therefore, since you have equal mathematical probability to be a Greek or Turk, you provide equal freedom for Greek and Turks. And you say, I want maximum freedom consistent with everyone's freedom. Why? Because I have equal chance to be anyone. You got that? Mm-hmm. You see now, he's still selfish. He's still rational. He prefers more to less. He wants more freedom rather than less freedom. And he wants the freedom just for himself. He doesn't give a shit for anybody else. He doesn't give a shit. But because he can be anyone, that's the reason he provides freedom
for
all. You understand this? Is that clear? Yes.
So you must have a consequence in order to think the right thing. You must think the consequence that I might be a Turk, so that's why I need to have...
No, I might be. He has equal probability. It's a matter of mathematical probabilities.
Now I see all theories. I understand that if you don't feel that you have some consequence, you won't choose the right thing. It's just a point of view.
It's different.
I see what you're saying. But this works on a different principle. It says, let's recognize that we are all selfish and rational. This is in our bones. It's our DNA. Nature gave it to us to protect us for perpetuation of the species. Otherwise, our species would disappear. So the only way for the species to perpetuate itself and have generation after generation is if we have these two characteristics. If we are selfish and rational, and protect ourselves, or it does. Okay. Who cannot get rid of it? The Soviet Union tried to get rid of that. The communists tried to get rid of rationality and selfishness. And they say, you cannot teach people not to be. You cannot take it out of our DNA. So Rawls says, accept that. What we need to get rid of is our subconscious biases that are put after we are born and live in a society, and our vested interests. After we are born, and we know that we are born in a rich family or a poor family, we are born strong or weak, we are born men or women, we are born Greeks or Turks, then we acquire vested interests. But before we are born, we don't have biases and we don't have vested interests. Those two things, you can get rid of them. So Rawls says, if we put ourselves behind a veil of ignorance, then we can be fair to others, despite our selfishness and rationality. Because why? Because behind a veil of ignorance and social status, we don't have vested interests, we don't have subconscious biases, and we have equal mathematical probability to be anyone.
That's it. Without that, nothing else
is possible. Of course. Let's move now. So we've got the first principle of the Constitution. Later on, I will tell you that I use this method. I tried this method to solve the Cyprus problem. I tried. I failed. Biases maintained. That's why. Why did you fail? Because they didn't accept my partner, who was a man, and I presented him as a woman. No, I'll tell you later. I will ask that question. Okay, but let's go now to the first law of the Constitution. That everyone will have the same freedom, consistent with anyone's freedom, regardless of sex, age, color, nationality, kiss. Okay? First rule. Second, in this society, do you want to have the opportunity to be educated and to get a job? Right? To be educated and to be to get a job and be paid and promoted to positions of power according to your merit, according to your contributions? Do you want that?
Yes.
How much opportunity do you want?
Maximum.
Maximum and?
Unlimited.
Equal with all?
Yes.
Equal for all? Why equal for all? Why do you care for the others?
Because I have the same
probably to be anyone else. Okay. Yes, we can be anyone. So, if I say I want opportunity for men, but not for women, if I turn out to be a man, I'm in great shape. If I'm a woman,
why should I be wanting to be paid or rewarded according to my contributions?
Why not?
I would prefer to be paid and rewarded according to my needs.
Okay, let's see this. This is exactly what they did in the former Soviet Union. I want to be rewarded and paid according to my needs. Okay?
Maximum.
Okay.
No, that's selfish.
No, let's say, according to my needs.
Okay.
According to his needs. Okay. Paid by whom?
I don't care.
Okay. Let's suppose you are according to your needs, okay? Someone has to pay for it. Who's going to pay for it? So, let's suppose you say that you want to be rewarded according to your needs, right? To be paid according to your needs, if you are one. Obviously, you cannot all of them, because all would get zero. Someone has to produce.
I don't know.
But what if you are in the position that you are the one who pay the taxes. We work hard, day and night, to earn the money, and I can't say, pay up, I have to give all these people, because they want to be to sit home and pay according to their needs. And all these people are saying they have a lot of needs.
Yeah.
So you know what happened? What happened in the Soviet Union? Well, everybody, in the Soviet Union was according to this. From everyone, we take according to his contributions. And to everyone, we give according to their needs. Put this in any optimization program in the computer, what is the solution? What is the solution to this problem? If you are taking for you according to your contribution, and giving you back according to your needs. What would be the solution?
Minimize
contributions, maximize needs. The contribution will in the optimal solution will come to zero, and the need will go to infinity. Hence, the collapse of the Soviet Union, the communist system. The collapse. Simple. There is nothing else. The collapse of the Soviet Union mathematically can be proven. A computer, a simple Excel problem, optimization thing will give you the code. Put in from everyone according to his contribution, to everyone according to his needs. In 2 seconds, the computer will give you the answer. The system will collapse.
Yes, but in this moment, where P is talking about a person which is selfish,
yes,
and rational, which takes more if it's offered, and I'm being offered.
You're not offered anything. Remember, you make the contribution. Here is a society you are going to live, where people are going to work, earn money, work, and be paid for what they contribute. And the question is, in this society, you want to have an opportunity to be educated so you can get a better position and be paid according to what? According to contribution. You want equal opportunity to be educated and to be appointed to positions and to be promoted according to merit. Why you say according to merit and not according to respect? Why? Because if you say according to respect and you happen to have a respect, then you are in great shape. But if you happen not to have the connection to get the respect, you are screwed.
Yeah.
And since you have equal mathematical probability to be either, you don't want to be screwed.
No, but you could have equal mathematical probabilities exactly to be a stupid guy,
yes,
which cannot practically contribute.
We come to that. We come to the social. Now, we are, yes.
Sorry, I am grown up in the Soviet Union, and it was not like this. It was for everyone by abilities,
yes,
and to everyone by contribution.
Yeah.
No, by needs. No, grown up in the Soviet Union, it was one of the slogans which we learned up to, I was 17 years old when the contribution on the Soviet Union role. It was from everyone by abilities, and to
I minimize my abilities, yes.
And to everyone by contribution. So,
what
yes.
is by contribution? What is by contribution?
Contribution means how much you work, you get. It was.
That's communist.
No, it was exactly like this. The Russian, the exact Russian translation, it was from everybody by their abilities, how much you can do. And you would get by what you contributed. So
but what about the
same thing?
Contribution
is not the same thing.
So
because if you may have a bigger needs, but you contributed less. You were paid by contribution, not by needs.
But how can you tell the contribution? You said, for example, I work 8 hours
yes,
a day.
Well,
another guy works 8 hours a day.
Correct,
I work faster than him.
No. The situation was following. You have the abilities to be a plumber, right?
Yes.
And you were paid as a plumber. If you worked 8 hours as a plumber, you were paid 8 hours.
Even though I didn't work at all. Even though.
There was not like this. In Soviet
but how can you
Union,
tell?
Sorry, that in Soviet Union, if you were not working, the government would thank you and give you work. It was a social.
If you work, but.
How many things can you do?
It was unsocial to work.
Right.
If you were not working, the community will create a special committee, will put you in front of it, and will make
What I mean?
It's not. I am a plumber.
We are both plumbers now. Now I can finish three houses in a day. Alex will only finish half a house in a day, but we get paid equal. What if I was slow?
Anyway, let's suppose. Okay.
In East Germany, it was different.
Okay.
In East Germany, if you had been underproducing, you were having penalties.
Okay.
And if you were not able to produce, you would get a substance. Otherwise, it's a different thing.
Okay. Anyway. Let's not confuse this. Maybe Irina knows it better than me. Let's go to our
example. The question was...
Now, the point... This may not have nothing to do with it. Okay, let's go. So, in a system where you have the high rate of ignorance of your status, you will choose equal opportunity for everyone. To be educated, to be paid according to the qualifications. Why? Because you have equal probability to be able. Okay. Now, let's come to the third one. Have we finished? Is that enough? You asked a question. You said, what if I cannot? I was born stupid. I was born disabled. I was born handicapped. You know, do you care about these people? Should we care?
Yes.
What?
If I have
the
probability, to be anyone, what do we want for these people? Should we provide for these people to have the same houses, the same cars, the same things as everybody, the same amenities as everybody else, the same income? Yes? No?
No.
What do you think?
No.
Think of it.
You can.
Why not?
You can because everybody is being rewarded according to his contributions. So there are different
But what about the people who cannot contribute?
So you cannot put them in the same rank as anyone else.
So to let them die in the streets?
No, you give them, but the question how is how much?
Give them a life.
Why don't they say, let's take this suggestion. Exactly the same. Okay? But in order to give them exactly the same, you have to tax all the other people who are working, right? So this person here works 15 hours a day, this person works 12 hours a day, and this person works 8 hours a day. We tax all these people in order for this to pay so that the people who don't work because they are disabled or whatever have exactly the same mansion as these guys, have the 3-4 of their service or whatever they have these guys, and everything is the same. Do you think it's fair? If you happen to be a disabled person, great, you are in good shape. You have this guy who works 15 hours a day and you take 2/3 of his income in order for those who don't work to have the same luxury as he has. What would he do this for his incentives to work, and is it fair for him?
Obviously not.
So, what would be a fair thing?
But he's disabled.
Disabled, but why would he live in Marshall?
He's disabled.
So, what do you want? If you are disabled, what do you want for yourself?
It doesn't matter.
A dignified life. You want a dignified life. Right? If you are able, you of course would like to wear, you know, as we said, to have the opportunity to get positions, to educate, according to merit, not according to respect, of course. And to contribute, also part of your income for the people who happen to be disabled. You want to provide for them because you have equal mathematical probability to be there. However, you would not want for them to have the same as the wealthy people. Why? Because if you are there, it's okay. But if you are the wealthy people who have to pay most of their salary in taxes, you will say you may have failed to them. Okay, and of course, the level of economic activity will go down if we get the incentives for work. There should be some kind of a difference. What you have, what you would provide, if you are behind the veil of ignorance, is a dignified life. And decent life, they have all their health services, they will have their transportation, they will have a comfortable home, but they don't need to have, right? The mansions of other people, let's say, who work. Now, of course, in the life, in the real life, are people who have mansions and they haven't worked in their lives because they happen to inherit it, they have a college. But remember, now that we're not talking about that, we're talking about
what you want to be.
Yes, what you want to be. Okay, so we conclude now, we came up with a constitution that the society we, the spirits, want to be born in, we want much equal, maximum freedom from, consistent with each other's freedom, because we could be anyone. We want equal, maximum opportunity for everybody to be educated and to be rewarded according to their contributions. And we want the disabled people, the disadvantaged people, the unable to work people to be taken well care of and provided with a dignified life. Because you know something, if the disabled people and the people who are old, the disabled and the ones who said who are not so smart, they are for the disadvantage or whatever, disabled people were to get the same privileges and the same houses, the same cars and so on, you know what would happen? Oh my God, my back. Oh, I was so disabled, I can't work. Oh, why should anybody work? If everybody can have the same privileges without working, it wouldn't work to work, right? Clear. Okay, so if we want to preserve a system where, you understand, the system is both a capitalist, but it has all elements also of community. Community, right?
Is your wife Scandinavian?
My wife?
Is she Scandinavian?
Yes. Why? Yeah.
It's a Scandinavian system.
It was. Oh no, but this has to do with Russia theory and not of for my wife. So this is the theory of roles, which says the following. Okay, a principle is a justified. It's a morally justified principle of justice if and only if the principle would be acceptable to a group of rational, self-interested persons, right, who know they will live in a society governed by principles they accept but do not know what sex, race, abilities, religion, social position, income, etc., each of them will possess in the future society. They are behind a veil of ignorance as to their status. Here? Because the parties to the original position are ignorant of their particular qualities, are free of vested interests, and are forced to be fair and impartial, they must look after the interests of all, because they can be anyone. Right? The principles that the imaginary parties to the original position, the spirits, or you now after you go back to original position, accept will by definition turn out to be morally justified because the original position incorporates the Kantian moral ideas of irreversibility. You get on the other side, you know, the reversibility is the order rule, universalization, right? Universal rule applies to you, applies to him, applies to everyone. Because each of you has the same mathematical probability to be anyone. Treating people as ends, not means. You remember this one? This is the second categorical imperative of Kant. So it means all the conditions of Kant. Okay. The parties of the original position will choose, in fact, Rawls' principles of justice. What are the principles of justice? These are the three of them. Is the principle of equal liberty, equal freedom. The principle of fair equality of opportunity, and the principle, okay, the difference principle, okay? This is for the disadvantaged people, for the least advantaged people, okay?
Question?
Yes.
The Rorschach theory seems very near to Kant's ideas.
Yes, it embodies the Kant's ideas. The boys then, but he People asked me before, how come someone will adopt Kantian ideas? So what Rawls tell us, how people can adopt Kantian ideas, right? Okay, so what are the advantages of the Rawlsian theory of justice? It supports the basic values embodied in our moral beliefs. Concern for the disadvantaged. Freedom, equality of opportunity. These are three things that, I mean, everybody believes. Everyone you will ask, they will say, yes, we believe in freedom, in equality of opportunity, and in taking care of the disadvantaged. It does not reject the inequalities resulting from the division of labor, and it shows how this can be remedied. It does not reject the market system. It does not reject the work incentives. It incorporates both the individualism and the communitarian spirit of Western culture. It encourages the more talented to use their skills in ways that would also benefit their fellow citizens who are less well off. It takes into account the criteria of need, ability, effort and contributions. Okay? In a way that you don't minimize contributions and you don't maximize, you don't maximize needs. Fair difference principle distributes benefits and burdens according to need. Fair equality of opportunity distributes benefits and burdens according to abilities and contributions. Now, question. Here, I ask you, 20 euros.
Yeah, I'll do it.
It falls from the sky like manna. Think about it. To whom should these 20 euros go to? Think. You are behind a veil of ignorance. You have equal chance to be Bill Gates or be a beggar or anyone else in between. Think and answer the question to whom these 20 euros should go to. There is a precise answer.
Which are the options?
It can go to any one of the 7 billion people in the world, including yourself. But you are behind a veil of ignorance. You don't know who of these people you are going to be, whether you are going to be Bill Gates or whether you are going to be a beggar in the street dying of starvation, or whether you be anyone in this class or anyone in this, of the 7 billion in the world. To whom these 20 euros should go to? Yes.
The least advantage?
Yeah.
To the poorest person. To the one who can make better use of it and can multiply it.
To the one who has the opportunity to be a.
You should make it go.
No. Try again.
He who contributes more.
To whatever you want. So, give it to Bill Gates or to. You know, the market is supposed to have contributed more to the welfare of people in the last 100 years?
Yes, by
Steve Jobs. So, let's give it to Steve Jobs. You haven't thought again. Think about it again. This falls from heaven, okay? You are behind the veil of ignorance. You have equal mathematical probability to be anyone. All right? You can be the richest or the poorest. You could be just short of a loaf of bread. A loaf of bread separates you between life and death. To whom this should go? You have equal probability to be that person or to be anyone.
Should be split equally to everybody? Or to me? To me.
George, have you thought about
to
it?
Me.
To you?
But it's selfish.
Who is you?
But it's selfish answer.
Everyone.
Me. Anyone, yeah, to me.
What do you mean to you?
Not to me.
You don't know who you are. You say
it doesn't
whom
matter.
You go in terms of wealth.
To the first one, who's
to me, then.
Let me help you a little bit more. To whom this would mean more?
To the poor.
No.
To the poorest of the poor. To the least disadvantaged out of the 7 billion. You have equal probability to be anyone of the 7 billion. and you could be even the one who is dying for starvation.
But if I am rich, I don't need these 20 euros.
That's of course you don't need. That's the reason you say this, you vote, that this should go. You don't know who you're voting.
Only for poor people and disabled people.
Exactly. You say that the answer is, according to this theory, the answer is that this should go to the least disadvantaged person in the entire whole world. Because
to the most disadvantaged. To the most disadvantaged.
To the most disadvantaged. Because it would mean the most to him. And this is what we have to provide it to be him, to him. Okay. Okay, you gave it to me. Thank you. Okay. Now, another